Hey guys, subscribe for daily content. And if you're shopping for gear, make sure you check out the description for the newest items at some of the very best online retailers. There's also links for some of the items that I personally recommend. Thanks.
What's going on YouTube? Metal Complex here, and today I've got another interesting knife review slash knife overview to share with you guys. This is the Vosteed Raccoon. This is a knife that has great materials for the money and has great manufacturing quality in terms of fit and finish throughout the knife. There's a lot of really impressive elements here. And when I unboxed it, I was very impressed. I was very excited about this because I thought, you know, this could be a contender for the best, budget knife for 2022. One of my favorite budget knives of all time. The button lock is something that I personally very much enjoy. So I got really excited about that. It does, however, have an issue, and we're going to talk about that. I believe this knife is available, so I will link it right down below if you guys want to check it out. It does help my channel when you use my links, but it's entirely up to you. Thanks so much to the gentleman who sent this knife in for me to take a look at. It'll go back to him when I'm done. Thanks to my patrons for supporting me, and please make sure to follow me on Instagram at metal_complex. Let's go ahead and get a measurement of this knife. Overall length of the Vosteed Raccoon coming in at 7.5 inches with a 3.25-inch blade. Cutting edge is coming in at about 3 inches. Let's go ahead and do just a few size comparisons here up against the Ontario Rat Model 1 and the Ontario Rat Model 2. Really looking forward to getting the nerves back in the end of my thumb so that I can deploy these knives again, but the time being, can't do that. Not enough strength there. How about up against the Demco 80 20.5? You can see they're a little bit shorter. How about up against the Spyder Copera 3? There we go. And last but not least, let's do the Benchmade Bug Out. Thankfully, I can still reverse flick it. Close to the size of the Bug Out, it's just a little bit thicker. How's the action on this knife? You push the button down and the blade falls, which is what we look for. Very easy to deploy with the middle finger here, and we're gonna use my left hand to deploy it with the thumb stud, which also works really well. Lefties, you should be able to manipulate this knife very easily, no lock stick or anything like that. Let's go ahead and do carry profile thickness up against the Spyder Copera 3. It's about the same length and height up against the PM2 and Para 3. You can see here this knife is maybe a little tiny, I don't know. It's actually like identical in length to the Para 3. It is still shorter though. You can see the hump clears it, so it's nowhere near as tall this way. So in the pocket, it should be pretty friendly. I'll give you guys the weight here real quick. We are looking at, in this case, micarta, and we are looking at 14C28N with milled and nested steel liners, which is exactly what I like to see with this style of knife in this price range. Weight is coming at 3.17 ounces, which means the ratios are extremely good. We have 3.25 inches of blade for 3.17 ounces of weight, and your actual balance is right behind the pivot. I mean right behind the pivot. So this guy is really well balanced, nice and compact, right? Not a huge knife, anything like that. Should be very friendly in the pocket. We'll go ahead and measure blade stock thickness here real quick. That's gonna come in at, my guess is 115 to 120 thousandths. Yeah, right there, it says 117.5 thousandths, so somewhere in there. And then let's go ahead and do a hardware check. I'll go ahead and get out my tools as per usual. My tools are very inexpensive and very recommendable. You can find them right down in the section of my description that talks about the tools I use on this channel. The pivot is a T8. And this screw up here, which is a nested liner screw, is a T6. This screw back here is a T8. Interesting choice. Why wouldn't you just make them both T8, right? We have T6 screws for the filler tab and for the pocket clip. No big deal. Pretty minimal hardware, you know, especially considering we are looking at nested. This is why the pocket clip is mounted right here, because it is one of the, it's like the positioning and integrity screw for, or these two are integrity screws for the nested liners, right? If they just had them back here, then that liner would sort of lip out underneath the micarta. But because we have these screws here and these screws here holding the back of the liner in place, that's not the case. I just wish they were T8. No big deal though. Still pretty minimal hardware. Should be pretty darn easy to take apart. Okay, let's go ahead and get into the meat and potatoes here. This guy has a very Spyderco smock-ish sort of choil area right here, and I really like that. This knife is quite a bit different, though, than the smock. I mean, people, I think, are going to immediately jump on that because the smock is operated with a button. Remember, the Spyderco smock is actually a button-operated liner lock. It's not actually a plunge lock, so it is different there. In terms of profile and dimensions, the smock is also quite a bit different. It's really just this area here and the fact that the blade is a similar generic shape, while the smock is more of a reverse tanto. And then the lines on the handle are, again, pretty classic and shared by thousands of other knives, right? So let's not jump to that conclusion there. It's just similar, right? Common knife profile. Ergonomically, it is very comfortable, and a lot of that is due to the chamfering on the edges here, and again, the classic knife handle lines. The reason that we see this handle so often is because it works, it's good, choked up, feels great. Back here, honestly, also feels great. The pocket clip is not a hot spot because, you can see here, this is why I always say this is what pocket clips should do, because they are functional in the sense of a clip, right? The way that a clip should clip the knife to your pants and hold it in place. But it's also, it's mainly the fact that we start to drop right off of the bend here, constantly tapering down, and then a slight swoop upwards. So this bill is nice and wide and rounded, but it's not grabby, right? It's still ramping upwards, which means as you push it into your pocket seam, it will lift to meet that pocket seam thickness, slide over your pants easily without having without the need for you to grab the seam of your pocket and the knife and sort of wiggle it in there, which just drives me absolutely insane. This is easy. In and out of the pocket, it's great. But it's rounded at the end, and it does not come up and go and just, you know, all over the place. It's just like a nice, simple clip that doesn't, you know, go way up in the air and try to reach out and grab everything that you walk by. It's nice and flat and rounded, so no hot spot, nothing there. Really nice. Would have been cool if we could have gotten it. I mean, my preference is that it's a little bit deeper, but truthfully, the carry depth is about medium, so it's not really that big of a deal. And, you know, while the lanyard hole is above it, it's not necessarily being prioritized because it's not like they had to move this down because the lanyard hole was here. I think it was more so because that's just sort of where the nested liner ends roughly. They probably could have moved it up a little bit, but that's where they want it. You know, it's like if you feel like deeper carry is better, then you're going to think they should have moved it up. If you don't mind it about right here, then, you know, you're going to be fine. And truthfully, it's the position of it is just fine. So no big deal. Thumb studs are in the right place for deployment. The button itself, very shallow, doesn't take much to disengage it, but then again, it is nested. I also like that they put a little metal ring around it instead of just leaving the lips of the micarta, which would have felt a little bit trashy. But no, they have this like metal hole here, and I like that. It's really nice. The pivot also looks nice. The overall presentation of the knife is basic, but it looks nice. Without the branding, I mean, it looks like, well, does it even have? Yeah, it says Vosteed right there. If it didn't say that, right? Any number of brands, right? You could be like, is that a QSP? Is it a Kubi? Is it a, you know, whoever? It looks like it could be any number of Kaiser, right? It could easily have been a Kaiser. But it looks good. It's sort of very much in style, I guess. But it still keeps those functional elements. There's some jimping back here, which is really nice. These edges are chamfered down enough. We have a nearly fully flat ground blade with a little flat up top. And I don't know what we call this, modified drop point, right? A sheep's point, whatever. Blade shape police are gonna come after me. I like that the nose is dropped because I can get my finger up here. Makes draw cuts a little bit easier, but we still have a nice belly for slicing. Behind the edge is pretty darn thin. This is a very generic blade shape. There's really nothing super special going on here, but the geometry of it is going to accentuate the properties of 14C28N very well. 14C28N is an incredibly well-rounded steel. It's one of the most well-rounded compositions out there. Great balance of edge retention, toughness, ease of sharpening, and corrosion resistance. And I think the geometry is great considering, you know, you're just going to be doing generic EDC cutting tasks with this, right? So, yeah, it's got a filler tab. Some people like that. Some people don't. I'm trying to get through this quickly because I know you guys want to know what's wrong with it. There's a backspacer. It's micarta. The micarta, by the way, on this looks pretty good. I am unaware of other variants of this knife, if there are. There's a couple. Obviously, they need to fix a major issue here because I'm rooting for this knife. I want this to be good, right? If they can fix the issue I'm going to talk about, I think multiple color options and, you know, coated blades, non-coated blades, all that, that should be an option because this is a good profile. It's a good design for sure. The pocket clip has the Vosteed logo on it, which is kind of cool. I kind of like their logo, but that's going to be preference. And really everything else out here, you know, it's got the lanyard hole. I don't know if there's really a whole lot more I can say. I mean, this is a really good EDC profile. So what is the issue, right? Well, so I typed in Vosteed Raccoon on Google to get the pricing. And I'll tell you guys right now, the price on it is about $60. And I was so happy to see that. I was like, oh man, this is awesome, right? $60, 14C28N micarta. I've got a micarta backspacer, good blade profile, all that. Really good manufacturing quality. Everything looks great. The centering was, I think, a little bit off, but I was like, well, this is somebody else's knife. You know, maybe just a quick tighten of the pivot. Locked it out, went side to side, forward and backwards. Didn't feel anything initially, right? A lot of times, that's about all that I do is just a little bit of force here, and I think, well, if it can withstand that much, then any excess is going to be exactly that, excess. However, I stumbled across a video on Reddit. And I always take Reddit with a grain of salt. I think Reddit, just like many other places, is where you get information online. There's some really great information to be had there, and then there's also just like absolute, you know, there's like people who become so... they drown in their own ego space, right? But that's anywhere online, right? You could say that about me too. So I always take it with a grain of salt. But I saw what I don't like to see is somebody, you know, testing their knife and then dismissing the entire company based on the failure of their knife, right? So what I saw was somebody doing this. It was pretty light tapping, and honestly, they just used pressure here and they could disengage it. And most of the time when I see that, I go, okay, this is an isolated incident. We have a situation where somebody is just really upset that their knife is doing that. Every single knife manufacturer who's ever made more than one of the same knife is susceptible to a small percentage of them failing, right? If you make 1,000 knives, there is no way that you will have all 1,000 of them perfect and not experience any failure. It's not possible, right? Anybody who expects that, if you expect companies to be able to have 1,000 for 1,000 perfection on functionality and absolutely no anomalies, no imperfections whatsoever, you have stupidly high standards and you need to reevaluate because it's just not, your standards are just impossibly high. You live in a fantasy world, right? It's just not, we're not there yet, right? Find a, you know, way to cryosleep and come back in 500 years and maybe, right? exaggerating. However, I was like, well, let's make sure, right? So yeah, there it was, just a little bit. I am not tapping very hard, guys. And I don't like to do that. I think it's ridiculous when I watch knife reviews and what they do is they swing with like 70% the force that you would use on a baseball bat. And they're like, look at this catastrophic failure. When and in what scenario would you swing a knife, the back of a knife, that hard against a solid surface? Well, the answer in most scenarios is never. And the answer in all scenarios is never. That's ridiculous. This test doesn't prove anything. However... this, oh, just a little bit. It's locked out here. Yeah, that's about all the force that it takes. Now, this is a bummer because it's doing exactly what I saw in that video. One isolated failure is not much proof of anything. Two is quite a bit more, right? Now, there's absolutely still a possibility that me and this person whose video I watched on Reddit are two incredibly isolated incidents, right? But it's weird, right? Most of the time when I test this, I find that theirs is goofing up and mine's okay, right? I even saw somebody do it with the 80-20 one time, right? I saw somebody really bad, and just to prove, right? I got no problem. Totally fine, right? More than that, like an insane amount more than that, I am literally denting the back of this with that force, right? This, fine. Any more than that would be excess, and it would be a, you know, you, like trying to prove a situation where that much force would naturally be applied to the back of your knife, right? Where that type of failure would actually mean something in day-to-day use, is that people aren't going to be able to do that. This, though, that's like, I mean, the amount of force it takes to disengage this, I honestly think, yeah, it slips with just hand pressure. So that is a bad twist cut away. Like if you jam a knife into something that's dense and thick and it kind of gets stuck and you kind of have to wiggle it back out, there's a chance, depending on how you're holding it, and anyway, that it could disengage and the blade could come down on your finger, which is bad. Maybe me and this other random Reddit person who I didn't look in enough to find out who it was. It's just somebody else who bought the knife, right? Maybe we, you know, I have a goofball sample here and he has a goofball sample, right? But kind of makes me think not the case. As it sits, I can't, it's too much. Like if it was just mine, I'd be like, well, everybody else on, this has happened before where I've had a goofball and everybody else, theirs has been fine, right? Like my Citadel. I was really upset with my Citadel from Artisan Cutlery because it was so weird on the inlays and it was so, like, it just didn't look good. And most other people were like, nah, man, mine's fine, right? Same with the Annex. I was a little bit upset with my Annex, but I was like, I was forced to conclude, well, that's how it goes sometimes. It's just random chance, right? You win some, you lose some. So I was kind of forced to accept that maybe I just had a weird one. In this case, though, I'm not so sure. It's kind of a bummer. I really want to like this, and I really want to be able to tell you guys that this is a wonderful knife and that you should rush out and buy it. I do, however, have faith because this, fortunately, is something that I think is easily correctable. We need to have a different geometry, and you can almost see back here, right? The angle, the tang angle, it's too steep. It's too steep, right? I've seen that before in frame locks, liner locks, right? The ones that slip, it's too steep, right? And they got to be careful about that because if they make it, you know, they make it too steep, you don't have any lock stick whatsoever, but it slips, right? You make it more straight, well, it's way more solid on the lockup, but then that plunge lock sticks, right? There's more surface contact. So finding that sweet spot can be a little bit difficult. I think they need to drop that tang angle a little bit, right? And perhaps do something different with the angle. If they do alter the angle of the plunge lock and it's not perfectly, right? Because the plunge lock is a cylinder, basically, that's sliding into position. They need to make sure that these two surfaces are contacting each other in a way that creates meaningful solidity and understandable, enough solidity to where the lock is reasonably strong under normal circumstances for a knife. They do not need to make this lock so durable that you can jam it in between two bricks, like on the side of a building, and then use the knife to scale said building. That is an unrealistic expectation of a pocket knife, and I will not hear arguments to support this. I'm sorry, I won't. Use a ladder, right? Just use a ladder. That's dumb. No, they need to make these surfaces more reliable, right? I'd honestly rather have a teeny tiny little bit of stick and have the, cause listen, if this had like a tiny bit of stick and the lock was reliable, I'd be like, this is one of the best button locks that's out there. It's one of the best in existence, right? Pyrite, still a little bit of a better deal, but man, this thing gave it a run for its money. One of the best I've handled, right? Love the quality, love the materials, functionality, all of that. Really like the look. It's good. Price is great. But that lock, that is a deal breaker. The lock has to lock. It's a folding knife. It's dangerous if the lock doesn't work. I'm really bummed to have to report that this thing disengages so easily, right? Really bummed. This is not excess force. This is a little, this is a plastic underneath. Listen, I got two layers of this vinyl upholstery. Two layers of this on top of a plastic table, right? It's not like I'm whacking this thing against a steel surface. Just a little bit of force, right? A pocket knife, a folding knife should be able to withstand that. As much as I hate the spine whack test, right? Yeah, that's too bad. This is going to be a no from me. Bummer. I'm hoping to, handle better knives from Vosteed in the future. And again, it's like I've said three times now, it's very possible that me and the person on Reddit both had goofballs. Maybe you're watching this right now and you're doing the same thing with your Vosteed Raccoon and it's not disengaging. That's great, right? All I can do is go off my experience and compare it with, you know, seeing that somebody else, you know, had this exact same experience, right? Considering they manufacture these are not like one at a time. They're not like individually checked. These are manufactured in, you know, mass quantity, which means they set the machines and they go, right? So the geometry of that lock needs to be changed. I have repeated myself many times. This review easily could have been no longer than 12 minutes, but we're at 21 minutes, right?
Well, that's how all your videos are. They could all be,
I don't really care. I like to talk, right? I know some people like to stick around. Bummer though. Wanted this to be good. Thanks again to the gentleman who let me take a look. I'm still happy. I am still rooting for Vosteed. I'm still rooting for this model. It would be really cool if they got that fixed and released a version 2 where this was taken care of, or a model that, you know, was similar. It's just like they just fixed the issue and gave it a different profile. That would be cool too. I'm going to keep my eye on Vosteed. I've got another one here that I'm going to take a look at, but I'm going to keep my eye on him. Please make sure to follow me on Instagram at metal_complex. If you enjoyed this video, leave a like. If you'd like to check out my other content, I do, of course, have lots of videos of knives that are either expensive or inexpensive that I do or don't like, so check those out. And if you enjoy all my content, go ahead and click on that Metal Complex logo right there and subscribe, because there's definitely more coming. Thanks again for watching, everybody, and have a great day.